Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're going to talk about characteristic impedance and a somewhat related topic of equivalent impedance. Sometimes these two terms are used interchangeably. They're not actually the same thing, but they do play on related concepts. So let's break down what each of these terms mean and how they're actually used by PCB designers and circuit designers. Let's get into it. First thing we're gonna look at is characteristic impedance. So this term is normally used to describe the impedance of a transmission line in a very specific case. So this is the impedance of a transmission line when it's not connected to anything at all. So it's a very specific impedance, and you don't always observe it in reality. The impedance of a transmission line, whenever someone says just the impedance of a transmission line, this is what they're referring to, is its characteristic impedance. So if I have a transmission line, normally when a transmission line is in a circuit, I have some voltage source and it's referenced to some ground. The output then connects to my line, and my line has certain circuit elements that's used to describe its equivalent electrical behavior. So first there's some series DC resistance. And this is just from the fact that copper, which we use on printed circuit boards, doesn't have zero resistance. There's always just a little bit of resistance. And it's usually in the neighborhood of about 0.1 ohm or 1 ohm or something like this. Just depends how wide and how big the transmission line is, but it's small. What's more important is the inductance of the line. And then the line also has some equivalent leakage resistance. And here we use L, here we use G. And then it also has some equivalent capacitance. And this is all back to ground. Okay, so we're assuming these are referenced to the same plane. In this model, these elements, my R, my L, my G, and my C, combine to give me a characteristic impedance. The way we actually model a transmission line electrically in a program like SPICE, or in a in like your circuit design program like Circuit Maker or Altium Designer, you actually have sections of this that are repeated, and you would repeat multiples of these. Generally, the way you would do that in SPICE is you have to define how fast the signal moves. We don't really want to get into the weeds on that because it's actually a bit involved, and we'll do a lot more content on transmission lines a bit later once we want to talk about wave propagation. For now, the important point here is to note that the R, the L, the G, and the C combine in a certain way to give me the characteristic impedance. So if I know these values, I can then calculate characteristic impedance. And so the characteristic impedance has a really simple formula. It's just Z is square root R plus I omega L divided by G plus I omega C. As long as I know these different terms for my transmission line, I can calculate the characteristic impedance. Here, the omega is my frequency. It's an angular frequency. So it's just 2 pi times whatever frequency my line is operating at. So let's say this is a transmission line that's carrying a 1 gigahertz radio signal, or maybe a sub 1 gigahertz signal, or it's carrying a 2.4 gigahertz signal, whatever it is. I know what my omega value is, and then I can plug that into this formula and figure out the impedance. Here, your C, your L, your G, and your R. So these are not so easy to calculate directly because the transmission line, the structure of a transmission line can actually be a bit complicated. And as a result, there is no nice closed formula for L, C, and G. Now, G actually, I kind of flubbed there just a moment, but G actually does have a bit of an easier formula, and you have to know something called the loss tangent. And when we talked about PCB materials in a previous video, the loss tangent is normally listed in your data sheet either as the words loss tangent or as D sub F. Dissipation factor. So you can use this to calculate your G value. Your DC resistance, that's probably the simplest one because it's just based on the cross section of a line. And there are actually calculators you can find online that will calculate this for you. Altium Designer will actually calculate the characteristic impedance for you in its stackup calculator. And other design software will have similar types of calculators with varying degrees of accuracy that you can use to also calculate the characteristic impedance.
Why is this so important, and why do we worry about this for equivalent impedance? Right now, I don't really want to focus so much on calculating the C and the G and the L in the transmission line characteristic impedance equation. The reason is that we'd probably spend multiple videos talking about that because it can get kind of complex. And there's a lot of research that's actually been done, including by myself, that focuses on figuring out how to calculate those using analytical formulas. So for now, what I actually want to focus on is why is it that characteristic impedance of a transmission line is not the same thing as an equivalent impedance? So if I look again at my transmission line and I just represent this as just some impedance, and the characteristic impedance is Z, and it's connected to a load. I think when most people see this, they have an instinct to say, oh, I have a transmission line in series with a load. So these two things should have an equivalent impedance of Z plus Z sub L. This would make sense if you think about it, right? It's actually wrong. Don't do that. The equivalent impedance of this system is only the sum of the two. Again, this is a transmission line. So the equivalent impedance of these two things is only the sum when you actually don't have a transmission line here. It's when this circuit is so small that the voltage or the signal that's output by this generator interacts with all of these elements simultaneously. That only happens at very low frequency or at DC. For practical purposes, when you're dealing with a transmission line, this relationship is not correct. So what we really have here on the transmission line is we have a signal, and I'm just gonna draw like a digital signal that's being output from the generator traveling this direction. So at any given time, the signal is only interacting with either my impedance of my transmission line or the load impedance. It's not necessarily both simultaneously. And it's only at this interface between the two that you have to consider what happens when a signal reaches the end of the line and the beginning of the load. And these two things come together, the transmission line impedance and the load impedance, they come together to determine what's called an input impedance. So what actually matters for a transmission line is not an equivalent impedance. It's actually something else entirely that's called the input impedance. The input impedance, you can actually look it up on Wikipedia, just Google input impedance of a transmission line. You'll probably find an article from Altium, you'll probably find an article from me, you'll probably find a Wikipedia article. Open up one of those articles, you're gonna find a formula that tells you what the input impedance of a transmission line is. There are also a lot of great educational resources, it's probably in a number of textbooks too. I'll put an article in the description that shows what this formula is and describes all this in a bit more detail. The long and the short of it is the input impedance, we're gonna call it Z sub in, is just the impedance that this signal sees. So when I say sees, it's the impedance that the signal interacts with as it's being injected into the line and traveling down the line towards the load. This input impedance depends on the length of the line as well as these two values, my Z and my Z sub L. So it's not an equivalent impedance. So now, what exactly is equivalent impedance? So let's look at this in a bit more detail. We just looked at how a transmission line produces an input impedance when it's connected to a load. You actually have a similar concept in circuits. And in circuits, we generally look at the equivalent impedance, not the input impedance. Again, they're not always the same thing. So in a circuit, let's just say again, I have a signal generator and I'm connected to a impedance Z1 and let's see, go ahead and go here, Z2, and go back to the other side, and we'll have Z3. Go back to your Electronics 101 class where you learned about Ohm's law and you learned about equivalent circuits and Kirchhoff's laws. I'm pretty sure everyone knows what the equivalent impedance of this circuit is. Essentially, the equivalent impedance says, I can take this network of resistors or capacitors or whatever it is, this network of impedances, and reduce it to an equivalent impedance, just using series and parallel rules. So here, my equivalent impedance is just ZEQ equals Z1 plus the parallel equivalent of Z2 and Z3. Pretty simple, right? Next question is, what happens if this circuit is actually the input to another component or another circuit network, something else that has a defined load impedance? Let's say I take this circuit and
I hook it up to a load impedance.
Now, what is the equivalent impedance? Well, the equivalent impedance just changed because now, instead of just Z2 in parallel with Z3, it's also in parallel with my Z load. The equivalent impedance seen at the input has now changed based on my load impedance. So this is where the correspondence between characteristic impedance and input impedance and equivalent impedance kind of tends to come up and confuse some people. Equivalent impedance here in this case can be seen as an input impedance because if I instead take off this signal generator and I hook up an ohm meter, I don't know what the symbol is for an ohm meter, but we're just gonna go with this for now. If I hook up an ohm meter here and measure the impedance, this is what I'm gonna measure. It's taken at the input port of the circuit, and it is the equivalent impedance. The reason here my impedance measured across the inputs is equal to my equivalent impedance is because we're not worried about wave propagation. We're not assuming that there are transmission lines connecting all of these different pieces in the circuit. If we did have transmission lines connecting these different impedances in the circuit, we wouldn't necessarily have this nice, easy equation. So the reason we have to make this distinction between characteristic impedance and equivalent impedance and input impedance is because in a transmission line, we have to consider that electromagnetic signals move at a defined velocity. There's a fixed velocity at which they move, and that determines which part of the circuit a signal is interacting with at any given time. In this case, there is a special case where if the load impedance takes a certain value, we would now have a case where the equivalent impedance with the load is the same as the equivalent impedance without the load. And if you go back to your, again, go back to your circuits 101, here if my load impedance goes to infinity, it's a horrible infinity sign, I know, but if it goes out to infinity, there's not gonna be any current going through this leg of the circuit. And so as a result, this wouldn't even appear in the equivalent impedance equation. Let's switch this up just a little bit, because this type of network is used with high impedance loads. But let's just say for a moment, instead, our output was not taken across Z3, our output was taken in series. Now what's our equivalent impedance going to be? And what's going to be the impedance I'm going to measure across this network? So if I put my load impedance here, now we've got a much different equation. My equivalent impedance is equal to Z1 in series with the parallel arrangement of Z2 and the series Z3 and my load impedance Z sub L.
And this is the equivalent impedance. Now, go back to Kirchhoff's laws. What happens if, let's say, the load impedance is very large or very small? Well, in order to make sure that this load impedance does not affect the impedance measured at the input, if this load impedance goes to zero, it's not gonna drop any voltage. So all of the voltage will be dropped across Z3. And so it's like the load isn't even there. So this type of circuit where you have a load that is in series with some element on the output is used with low impedance loads. And that's going to cause the impedance measured at the input to be equal to the equivalent impedance. So these are some interesting ways to think about input impedance and equivalent impedance. And I think there's a propensity to look at a circuit simulation. It doesn't really matter what program you're using, but to look at a circuit simulation and be a bit surprised when you hook up a load in a circuit like this and the load has a high impedance, and suddenly the impedance that you measure in the circuit does not measure, or does not match, I should say, the impedance that you generally measure across the input without the load. And this is because, again, the load modifies the impedance that you measure at the input. Same for a transmission line, same for a regular circuit. We call them different things. So it's important to remember the terminology and then just remember some of the basics of circuits and how loads and how different impedances affect each other to produce equivalent impedances. Okay, everybody, thanks for watching. And I hope this video has helped clear up some terminology that can sometimes be confusing for newer designers. And it's easy to confuse these terms with each other, but hopefully this helps clear things up. Now, if you're looking for a great PCB design program that you can use to create the types of circuits that we presented on the board, go check out Circuit Maker. Circuit Maker includes a schematic editor that you can use to create these circuits. You can run simulations, and then you can transfer all of your circuits into your PCB layout and create your physical design. You can also create manufacturing files, take your board into fabrication and assembly. Thanks for watching, everybody. Hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, leave your questions and comments, and don't forget to call your fabricator.